physics, really, we have some theories that we have some experimental evidence. And the things don't go together, this is a paradox. And maybe the main paradox is just measurement problem. The standard quantum mechanics tell us that we have a wave equation is go here and here, but we come to a laboratory and see it only here. So it's kind of inconsistency, it's a paradox which have to be resolved by this or other means. So I think there are two main kind of situations. Sometimes we see something we don't. We take a theory, we try to understand what's going on, and we don't get exactly what we see. And this tells us that maybe we don't exactly understand the theory, and maybe we need to correct something about it. And sometimes the theory is fine, but experience tells us that something is different. It means that we need new theory. And this is the most important paradoxes, and this is how physics goes forward. So, my lecture will be about many words. From my point of view, it solves all the interpretation paradoxes of quantum mechanics. And so we need something else, not to talk only about interpretation. So for me, it will be many paradoxes when things are different from what we would expect it, but they're kind of they're different. And this tells us paradox, and then you can understand better that they're not different. Understand even deeper, they're still different. So there are many paradoxes. This will be in the other lectures. But I want to start with the paradox. It's my favorite one, and some people know it, but people who don't know it, I think it's a good thing to think about. I need the resolution of it for my last lecture, and I think this is really a paradox of the important type, which brings new theories. So let's start with this paradox. I consider a kind of simple experiment, and I analyze it in two frame references, and I came to two different conclusions, which tell us that I probably should be mistaken sometimes. So we have, let's say, very big or infinite plate, a charged plate. So this is charged plate, and Alice stands on this plate, and Bob moves relative to this plate with constant velocity. Now Alice takes some particle, charged particles, and throw it, like you see here. And let's say forget about gravity, also gravity can be taken into account. And she wants to calculate, she wants to help her friend. Because her friend asks her what he will see. Her friend is moving, so she calculates for him what he will see. But it turned out that the friend also studied some physics a long time ago. So he decided to understand why he sees what he sees. So he also calculates what he's supposed to see. And at least for how I'll present it, probably or maybe I make some cheating here in some places. And so this is an idea for you to find. So he finds some different result. So she calculates what he will see, he calculates what he will see, and they get different result. It's not, of course, she might see one trajectory, he can see another trajectory, but she calculates for him, and seemingly in the correct way, and he seemingly correctly calculates too. So this is a paradox. This tells us that something in this theory is going wrong, or transformation, or any other thing. So let's go a little to details. So this is particle. The friend goes, he has constant velocity. This constant velocity equals exactly to the horizontal component of the velocity of the particle. And for simplicity, it doesn't matter. Let's say he stands under the particle. Anyway, which trajectory he will see, this is a question. So this is from his point of view. From his point of view, Alice and the plate moves, and he stays. So let's calculate make Alice's calculation. And we have constant field, charged particle, constant electric field, and so it should accelerate vertically. It should go no field, no horizontal field. So we expect, let's make it two dimensions simple. This is kind of supposed to be a motion, and constant field, constant force, constant acceleration in y direction, no acceleration in x direction, so this is a motion in x direction, initial position v2 plus vt, and this is accelerated motion in vertical direction. So, from his point of view, he moves like this. So, what he sees, he doesn't see this horizontal component because his initial, his velocity equal to horizontal component of the particle. So from his point of view, there is no velocity in x direction, there is only motion in y direction. So this is how Alice thinks for him. So she thinks that the trajectory should be a straight line up. And this is what she tells Bob, that your trajectory is up, because she calculates in her frame, and then she makes Galileo or Lorentz transformation to another frame. The trajectory is a straight line. Now, Bob. Bob says particle go up, but he also sees that this infinite plane moving. Infinite plane is really a charged plane, so it's a current. So when we have current, then we get magnetic fields. So he says that there is a magnetic field, and you can calculate either magnetic field, maybe using electric field and the Lorentz transformation or any other way, and he finds this magnetic field. Electric field is the same, or maybe slightly higher, but they can become relativistic correction. And this is the following. There is a, from his point of view, there is electric field which we force up, but also there is a magnetic field to the left. Let's make it two dimensions, it's simpler. The motion is like this, magnetic field is like this because it's move, so it's a current. So we have an electric field which accelerates vertically, but there is a magnetic field which bends the trajectory. So from his point of view, it's it's curved line. Bob says curved line. Alice says that Bob should see straight line, so who's right? So this is the paradox. I will try to put this, you know, here there is a Wi-Fi someplace, sometimes okay, sometimes less okay. So I will try to put this in some my slides if somebody wants to see them again. And if somebody never heard about this, please come to me and give me the solution on this paradox.
Can I comment on this?
Yes.
Just, I think the relativity should be taken into account.
It seems, yeah, of course. This is what we studied in high school, and we thought it's consistent. Now, of course, maybe relativity solved it, but not. Celso doesn't see how relativity solved it. It should be physics. You can use whatever physics you know. The first thing, what is the straight line, the curved line, and where is the mistake in the calculation?
Bob's point of view, the fact that he will have a...
Because for Eric, There is no magnetic field.
Because that's right, there is no magnetic field. What is...
Then we,
I think it's a good idea to use different frame of reference. Please.
EM force.
Yeah, please.
This is the sense for
please.
Problem.
Please.
No, don't speak. We just.
It's a good idea to use sometimes one frame of reference, sometimes another frame of reference. It's very helpful. And these two inertial frames, so the calculation should be correct in both frames. So then there should be consistency. It's not that you say, let's, Alice, your advice, use Bob's frame and no problem. No, we have to be able to understand it in every frame. In some frames, sometimes it's much easier to solve than in others. So it's a good idea to be able to solve it in different frames and to make translation from one frame to another. So, Alice, Bob's looks okay, but Alice also looks okay. Something. Transformation also looks okay. Something is not okay because there is a contradiction. So the question, well, what's new can be learned from this? But okay, I don't want. Let's. Yes. Sorry. Just this is Alice's. This is what Alice thinks for Bob. Bob, I see curved line. So it cannot be that Bob see curved line and straight line simultaneously. Maybe in parallel words, but this will be the next. Okay. Do we need the slides? I think on many works I'm working for many years. I have to say that Dave Albert brought it to me and he doesn't believe it in it anymore. My first paper was written in South Carolina before 1990. It was published 9 years later. But essentially I started to think about then. And only now I got a grant to work on many words interpretation. So I'm looking for a philosophy postdoc. Maybe I feel that I understand everything, but still I have a grant, so I have to at least search what I don't understand. Okay, but let's. The goal of physics, at least for me, it's understanding the world. My thesis is that quantum mechanics explained it. But the only way I can understand the world with quantum mechanics is only through many world interpretation. And I think there is a good explanation of everything which we see. I don't know about quantum gravity, let's put it aside. Everything else, as far as I know, quantum mechanics explained very well. Now, maybe the simplest way to present the argument is the following. Everyone studies quantum mechanics, textbook, go to a laboratory and use it, build devices, and everything is okay. So, if you use textbook quantum mechanics, then there is a correspondence with, there's no contradiction with experience. People build machine using textbook quantum mechanics, everything works well. The only problem is that in textbook quantum mechanics, there is this collapse postulate, which is, from my point of view, cannot be understood. So, I will go from the following. Quantum textbook explains well everything we see around. So when teachers tell use textbook and this explains quantum mechanics, it's well. There is this philosophical issue about collapse, which is unresolvable. And the many world resolve it by the fact that there is no collapse. So what's left is just to explain our experience given the fact that there is no collapse, which is kind of strange. The wave function tells us it's here and here, but we go to the laboratory, we see it only here. This is about paradoxes. So one more interlude, I will present the paradox which allowed me essentially to make my career, because I got failure more or less, I think, maybe because of this became famous. So I started with interaction free measurement, which looks like a paradox. I hope to end in time, so I'll say how why it's related to many words, because I think it is a paradox if you don't believe in many words. But first I present it as a paradox. And then I will go to many words, starting from, we'll see, maybe real experiment or maybe simulation, depending on the Wi-Fi here. Then I'll talk about testing many words. It's not just interpretation. In principle, it can be tested. And then some issues about why people have difficulty to accept many words and how I understand it. Many words tell us that everything is a wave function, and some people say wave function is in high dimensional Hilbert space and we live in three dimensional space, so we have to connect it with many words, this wave function, to three dimension. And the probability is kind of also a tough issue, which I believe I did some contribution at least how I view the issue of probability in many words. Okay. Interaction-free measurement. This is sometimes. Sorry, this was supposed to be a picture of a bomb. Some projectors. Some projectors. I couldn't foresee it. Yeah, it's kept, not the first time. So here there is kind of a bomb, which was much smaller before, and this it's really 100% efficient detector. You send a photon, it explodes every time a photon reaches there. And I think with this happened also in 1991 or 1990, Avi Litzur came to me and asked, let's say we have such a device, which is super sensitive to everything, can we find it without exploding? This device, whatever you touch it, it explodes. Can we find it without exploding? Maybe there's quantum mechanics, position, whatever, and it's kind of, yeah, even there is a noise of explosion. So this was the question. So, can we find it without exploding it? And turned out we found the solution, which was in fact was extremely simple and hard for me to understand why no one was talking about this before. Maybe in some other way it was kind of, we made a mistake that put the same name, interaction-free measurement. Dickey was talking about something in the direction, but he didn't ask this question. So, now what is a paradox? A paradox is we have the device. The only way to find it is to touch it. When you touch it, it explodes. So if you find it without exploding, it's clearly a paradox. So this is a paradox, and I think it's really a big paradox. This is kind of, this is causality, locality. The only thing to find this object is be with it. And so, but very simple solution, tuned Mach-Zehnder interferometer, or maybe as interferometer, Mach-Zehnder maybe, I think it's more clear, more simple. And you put it in such a way, here maybe there is a bomb. And so we have this.
Maybe you can explain what the Mach-Zehnder interferometer is, what the parts are.
You think it's needed? How many need explanation of Mach-Zehnder interferometer? Okay. So, Mach-Zehnder interferometer, in fact, is a very old device. I don't know exactly the history, 180 something. It was done with light. We have a light. Here we have a piece of glass which splits the light here and light here. Here there is a mirror, and here there is another mirror. And here there is one more piece of glass. And so it can go through. Every time you send a beam here, partly reflected and partly transmitted. For simple case, let's say 50% here, 50% here. So then, it's a long time ago. People right. It's you can arrange sometimes that if you put 50, let's say I block this. If I block this, then I get 50% here, 50% here, and then 25% here, and 25% here. I can arrange when I open it, I'll get nothing here. Even I block here, I get again 25%. Two together can have destructive interference when I tune it very properly. And so it's important to understand Mark Zander, because it will be not in one, in more than maybe in every talk. I don't have Mark Zander in this problem. It's important that about 40 years ago, Granger and Aspect did this experiment with single photons, which this is kind of strange. You have a particle which kind of must be both here and both here, because one thing before it was with light. Light, of course, there are waves here, the wave interference. You can see this effect in the sea or in the water. But with particles, it's kind of strange. So it tells us that the particle has to be here and here. This essentially, many words, is very close to this, just the same, not just particle, but maybe me can be here and here. And so, if the distance exactly equal from this side and from this side, and so we can arrange, and in the laboratory of Young, how much, what is the feasibility which we got? You got the maximum, 99, at least, yes. 99% is here, essentially we get nothing. But, of course, if we block, if we block, then we'll get something. So the question is, there is a bomb here or there is no. We place this single photon, this Mach Zehnder interferometer, and we send a single photon. We send a single photon. If the bomb is here, this can click. So when this click, we know, there is a bomb there. And the bomb will not be exploded. You cannot, the single photon can be found in two places. This is the whole point of single photon. Can be, so if you found it here, it could be here. So we know that the bomb is here, and clearly the photon was not here. So we didn't touch it. We didn't touch it, we know it's there. And so this is kind of strange. We know the bomb is there, nothing touched the bomb. This is a paradox. I hope how many more. And for me, it's really a big paradox. I think it should be like this. All physics, which I understand, is I want that this thing, something will happen to it, I have to move it. And if there is a dark corner there, I've never been there, something has to move from there to give me this information. Doesn't. I don't believe in any other thing. This is what physics is about, explanation. And explanation is kind of causality. Causality is everything. This kind of local causality. And here, I got information about this, and nothing was here. If this is real paradox. Okay. Let's go to many words. If everyone can go to my homepage, and from my homepage there is a work quantum word splitter in the basement of the Tel Aviv University. There is this kind of device, and now you can split the word. Let's see. Let's see if it works. Yeah, it works. So, let's say, usually when I put L, you can split up to six chords. If there are six places in your city and you don't know which to go, you just go here, split it to six, put the names of all these places, and then one of you will be in every of this place. This idea. So I put left and right. No. I didn't put right. So it just sorry, I'm still in anyway, you will try when there is a good Wi-Fi connection, you will be able to do this. Now it's theory is that if it would say me left, I will move to the left, but it told me right, so I move to the right. And let's assume it's not simulation. I really believe that there is another of me there, and now hopefully you look at me there, and but you'll now look at me here. And so I continue my talk from here, and probably now we kind of cross each other. And this is the meaning of many words. It's my belief that in this world there is this one story, which I'm continuing my lecture, and there is a parallel story, which I'm continuing my lecture slightly different. Because I start moving from the other side too. From now on, everything will be slightly different. So, conceptually, what is there is this experiment. It's a now there is no single photon source, there is a laser, but it's really, there is no this experiment either. But conceptually, we have a single photon source, and then we have these two options. In real life, we have a weak laser, and we have single photon detectors, this we do have. And depending on the time the detection happens, then there is algorithm and it tells you split between 2 or 3 or 6 or whatever. And this is a purely quantum effect in which when you have a weak amplitude, then there is a quantum probability of detection in different times. So this is really a quantum situation. Here we can see there are two options, but what I believe that are both of them happen. I believe that photons go here and photons don't go here. And in this other case, there are in all windows of time there were detections, so all worlds would go here. So the two world universe, that's simple, that everything started from here, the single photon go here, tell us that if I have two detectors, this will click and this will click, both will click. And from now on, everything is parallel. And then there are some people who saw this click, they probably will not, they can figure out that they look, they want to understand nature, they will have to admit that there is another one. But they will, this other one will not disturb physically. There is no really communication between worlds. It's not impossible. It is possible, otherwise many words is not interesting. Many words is just saying that quantum mechanics is correct. And I think sociologically what happened to Witt, who kind of helped Everett to push this forward, he spoiled the many words. He kind of said that words are splitting. In his many words there is one option and another option, all these options are separate. This is not true. In principle, if there is a super technology, they can be brought together. So, maybe this kind of, I demonstrated here that I go and I don't bounce to another left, which also worked here. And this may be strange, but this I can go to a laboratory to see is that this is really what happened. If I send neutrons going like this, and let's say here they scatter, I will see no scattering when I see one neutron and put it in a superposition. This arm and this arm, neutrons in a superposition or even electron, whatever, will not feel each other. I can make an experiment. I can block it and see if something could happen here would be different. Now I expect that maybe more photons will come here, or neutrons, because nothing disturbed it. But we'll see no difference in this experiment or this experiment. The same intensity will come here. There is no difference. So this photon, it will come here, they will never scatter. The test of many words, saying that many words is not just kind of stories. In principle, I kind of can test the many words. Again, what test? For example, this test will not tell me if many words is true or bomb is true. This test that there is no collapse. Because how to test that there is no collapse? First, I have to make an experiment when collapse happens. Maybe the minimal detectors, which kind of people will agree that okay, this photon multiplier is big enough to make a collapse. So after we got this at this moment, now we spend $1 million to a special device which will erase the memory of my photomultipliers, will erase everything, it will reverse the whole process. So if many words is true, then no memory stay here, and half of the wave will go here, half of the wave will go here, and everything in quantum mechanics is time reversible. So if it's come from here, then there should be interference, destructive to here, constructive back to the source. So this detector should be silent. Now, if many words is not true, but what really happened, it's kind of big. And after this, we have only kind of one result here. So from here, nothing will come out, because it was not detected. And if photon come here, from here, there's a 50% chance to go here. So I have to repeat it several times, and it will see that this is silent, then many words is true. If it's not silent, then our device was lousy. Okay.
Sorry, can you say again how it connects to the many words?
The many words says that every. This is the main thing. If I have a single atom, so this is. This kind of experiment are done in many places. Single photon source, two detectors. You expect the equation tell you the wave both here and here. There is no equation which will tell you that it should be here or randomly, independent if you move it a little. It's always the wave here and here, but you go to a laboratory and you see it only in one place. And then one says, okay, the equation not true. If it says that it's here, there's a unit revolution with photomultiplier which became excited. And in parallel, here. So in many words, the equation tells us this clicks and in parallel in superposition this also clicks. So this I want to check if it's true or not true. Then I have to undo everything. When I do everything, and if it was here and here, it will go well. Will be both here and here, and then it must go here. The alternative interpretation say, no, this kind of situation, then single photon clicked in two detectors never happened. Immediately one, it will be collapsed, maybe in the beginning. This is what Van Neumann says. First we create a superposition, and then it collapses to one macroscopic outcome. Or GRW collapses to one outcome. Only one will be here. So now, our device, here it was nothing, so nothing could go from here because no detection was here. So it would go only from here. From here, when my photon, okay, 50% should go here. If I never here click in this detector, I know that my equations were correct. So both was excitation here and excitation here. So both words were present. This is how I know that the many words are. Yes?
Could you say the experiment proves that macroscopic superposition exists?
Yes, but this is many words. Because what's many words says it. There is only one word. But different macroscopic superposition, different stories. This is many words. It's a different. There is a one physical. Many words is a one physical word with many stories like we see around. So this result is one word. This result is another word. I start moving from the right, I start moving from the left. These are multiple words. So, this experiment will tell us that they really exist all in parallel.
So, this experiment has not been done in practice because it's too hard to actually time reverse any detector.
It's, I would like to say yes and no, I have to say no and yes. There is a movement towards this experiment. People did an experiment with molecules of 1,000 atoms. But most people who kind of believe in collapse theory say, no, 1,000 atoms is not enough to make a collapse. So, till now, no one has seen any effect of collapse, but there is a big room to say that maybe we are not in any situation to see the collapse. So. And depends on skeptics. Some people will say, no, photomultiplier is not good enough. Other people say, you need PhD student who writes in a notebook until the collapse happened. So, but I think that I'm persuaded. I don't need any of this kind of experiment, but I think more and more people should be persuaded by the fact that quantum mechanics works, especially because of superconductivity, it's superfluidity, which we have many, many particles, and quantum mechanics is still working. Yes.
Where is the source of this other photon, which makes detector A to click? So you said that at both time detector A and detector B clicks. When you send single photon from single photon.
So, you're agreeing that when you send a photon
yes.
here, that there is a photon, the photon goes here and here.
Two-wave packets.
Yes.
Okay.
One wave packet leads to one detector click and the other to the other.
Okay.
So later, this wave packet, half of it, it's a small wave packet,
okay.
will go to this photon multiplier, and there is a unitary evolution, and everybody agrees that if it's a half photon or the whole photon, the evolution is to calculate what will happen here, it's the same.
But there is no half photon.
What do you mean? Of course there is half. What a problem. If I take, if today there is a single photon, this is a difficult task to make a single photon. But at the moment I made a single photon, I put a piece of glass, automatically it's a half photon. This is how the amplitude here corresponds to the half photon. Exactly half.
Okay.
You get two wave packets for the same photon.
Okay.
Oh, there's another question.
Yeah.
I just got this right. So you could verify the many world theory by this experiment that you had some device that would reverse, so to speak, the photon fly from the A and B detectors back to the source. Is that correct?
Yes. Because some people would like to put a person here to know that there was warp, that he was in warp B, and then to tell. This will never happen. You will have to erase his memory.
Yeah.
The only way is that when you do this experiment, if I construct all this, and I know that the only way for me to explain that there is no click here, that there must be me excited, photon multiplier excited here, and photon multiplier excited here. And for excited photon multiplier, this is a world. Different story. Because we have never seen in laboratory that a single photon excites two photon multipliers. But I want to say no, we haven't seen it because we build like this. We are local agents, we cannot see these things. We can see only one. If we'll try to see, we'll also split. But now I want to say that this is really happening. There is a photon multiplier excited here and here in parallel in superposition.
So one more question. The fact of erasing the memory then fuses back the universes? Or
Correct. In this stage there is a single universe. Now when there are these clicks, from my point, my definition of universe, there are two words, twice as much as before. But now we came back to the, again, one. Yes.
So by erasing
the memory? Yes, the words come back together. This is why the read story doesn't, will not work here. So. Yes.
Could you say how it's different from other interpretations and how it computes it?
So the bone will say all these waves are there and it's okay, but we, at least my version of bone, some people don't necessarily agree with me, that we built like this, that our experience only for this something additional variable, which is called Bowman position. So in addition to this wave function, which from my point of view is a whole story, I have something else. And this something else, this is what's connected to experience. And this else has only one story. Maybe the particle, the Bowman particle, will start here, will go either here or here. So one of them will be kind of empty wave photon multiplier. So it's there, and this experiment will, the Bowman will say it's completely agree with it. It's not, it's a problem or not problem, you cannot distinguish. 99.9%, I'm sure. You cannot distinguish experimentally between bomb and many worlds. So, but for me, the bomb is more complicated. Add something. Why to add if it's not needed? So.
But
test against collapse theory. The collapse theory will say different. All collapse theory is a real collapse, or even formal collapse of von Neumann will say that 50% of the chance I will get clicks. So it's that this is a test against collapse theory, it's not a test against Bose theory. Okay, so it's a story, all is psi. So I hope that this is explained everything. But even bigger hope that it's really the big hope that explains everything. The hope, the small hope, that except, this is not a hope, this is true. Today's quantum mechanics explains everything we have seen in the laboratory. This is correct. But the hope, it's everything, and if it's not wave function, I don't, you know, we can add this position, but I, again, Bohr said, Bohr taught us that, and maybe historically for 10 years, there was quantum effects and no quantum theory. And I think during these 10 years, Bohr succeeded to kind of brainwash the community that no one would understand quantum mechanics. Till now, I can find quotation for, I think, almost all professors who taught quantum mechanics in Television University and many others, Feynman, whatever, no one understands quantum mechanics. I think it's just because for the period, they introduce this complementarity, whatever, no way to understand it. Quantum mechanics is a wave theory. Everything is a wave. And then, so I don't, so I think we should not give up the idea that we can understand quantum mechanics. And for me, understanding quantum mechanics is just this big wave function, a single physical universe which has a single wave function. It corresponds to multiple stories, to many things which we know. So we have a century ago, in fact, was kind of similar situation. People felt that they understand physics. This was Laplacian physics. There they said that everything explained by motion of particles and interaction between them. And it turned out that they were wrong, kind of strongly wrong, both quantum mechanics and special and relativity. And I think there's another reason why today people are kind of afraid to say that they understand physics. The fact that today physics calculates things with the precision of 10 figures and then go to a laboratory and measures with the same 10 figures tells me it should be right. And there is no example when it doesn't work. There are some astrophysical examples that I did not fully understand, but it's minor. It's not the clouds of what happened 10 centuries ago when this classical mechanics couldn't explain important things like why things are stable, many this kind of thing. Okay, so in classical physics, the connection between the theory and observation is kind of trivial, because if this table is made out of particles, it looks like this particle, the set of particles made out of the table, it just looks like a table. In many world interpretations, the wave function is everywhere, kind of. You don't see it easily. If I know the wave function of the universe, it's not easy for me to see these tables there. Because there are many tables, in fact. There is all together. The correspondence is difficult. It's just not one experience, many. There are many. Again. Sorry, partly. There is, in many words, we have this one wave function. It corresponds to many words. Every word is kind of experience. So this big wave function can be decomposed to the superposition of this wave function, which I call word wave function. Every word is corresponds to definite experience. Every macroscopic object have to have well localized state. In a word, it cannot be that, you know, I cannot have a cat here and here. There is no Schrödinger cat in many words. There is a one cat which is cat alive, and there are many words with cat dead in different times. By definition, a word is something when all macroscopic objects are well localized. This is slightly different from the original Everett, which he put the observer, and then everything was relative to observer. The other one is also good. All this, so many word theory tell us. There is an equation, quantum equation, and there is no collapse. And this is a whole physical story. From now on, we have to connect, to find correspondence to our experience. It can be done in different ways. It's an experience, it's kind of, it's not exact science, it's social science, so it can be in way. So I have particular semantics, and other people have slightly different semantics. Everett is also good. I think this is slightly easier to understand, but okay. And so, if all macroscopic objects are well localized, they must be a product. All macroscopic objects, they are wave function, are not entangled. They cannot be well localized and entangled with something else. So, all objects are kind of. Then we have many other particles, neutrinos, so maybe some electrons in my hand. They are entangled inside atoms. But my hand has a well localized position inside the world. This is in particular world. This is what particular world wave function. So let's come back to the textbook on quantum mechanics. Because I want to say that it's good, and some people say it's not so good. In textbook quantum mechanics, we had this maybe the splitting of possible worlds, but there was collapse to one of them. So it also says that the whole story is a wave function. For example, GRW, today GRW has this variation of GRW flashes and GRW this mass density, especially flashes. This is why do you need this? I still prefer every theory, which is better. A wave function is the whole story. So I think from this point of view, this theory is also good. I don't need anything more than the wave function. But the founder of this institute, Tim Alvin, I think was the strongest opponent, because he said how it can be that everything is a wave function when the wave function lives in many dimensions. Let's come to this. So there is one rule I'll talk later. Experience. The only thing is the wave function. So experience connected only to the wave function, even in the standard quantum textbook quantum mechanics. So there is only wave function. It's collapsed wave function. It doesn't have this strange thing. Every time we try to make a measurement, we never get two results. It collapses to one result. After it collapses to one result, we have experience of one result. And the problem. The wave function is in a very high dimensional space. For every particle, we have three dimension multiplied by the number of particles, maybe also fields. So, it's my way to resolve it. There is this universal wave function. It's not connected to my experience. My experience connected to a world wave function. To many, there are different me, different worlds. But in every world, the wave function has a special form. All macroscopic objects are not entangled. They are product state. So they have they in three dimensions. Now there are some relative particles in these macroscopic bodies. They might be entangled, like atoms, molecules, whatever. But they are not really, if I want to lift it, I lift it with all my hand. So I need the wave function of this of this object and the wave function of my hand to explain it. Everything in three dimensions. So explanation is, as we see, there is now all this entanglement, which is difficult. We need three n dimension for entanglement. We cannot do it without this many dimensions. But entanglement doesn't do the job. When we act, when we behave depending, when describe the classical, the story which we understand, it's all in three dimensions.
Does CM mean center of mass?
Yes, yes. It can be center of mass, you can define it as slightly different, but I guess my, at least one of the simple ideas is center of mass. Again, you can center of num, you can, there are all kinds of ways. So, experience corresponds to macroscopic object. Macroscopic objects live in three dimensions, so then it's understandable. And so then we have this product state of this macroscopic object. And the entanglement is not a problem. To live is to interact, and we live in three dimensions, so there is a, the life is in three dimensions. So this is my answer, Tim. Now, one thing which I understand that will be much more discussed later, it's a collapse. So the reason, the main reason why we live in many worlds, I don't like many worlds. I would like to prefer that I'm the only one and there is no copy of me there. But I don't, I cannot explain what's going around. The only way to explain is collapse, but collapse is not acceptable. Why I've seen the collapse is not acceptable, it's not just me, people say it's you know, kind of not well defined, it's for me, it's introduced randomness. And I think it's a quantum revolution which brought idea that randomness is okay for science. This was not like this. And philosophers still think that it's a bad idea. If you don't have any other options, then okay, then believe that something is random. The good science is that you know exactly what happened. The good science is deterministic theory. The random theory is not, is less good. If you fail to find deterministic theory, okay, get the theory which is has randomness. And it has action at a distance, which the whole explanation is, I understand what's going on, to give a lecture here, I have to come here. The Skype or whatever, but it's also kind of a local explanation. If there is a non-locality, there is no reasons to talk about this local object. Why we are local? Because interactions are local in nature, so all agents, all kind of conscious beings, they must be local. And so we don't want action at a distance. I think that some people with Copenhagen, with other things, they're trying to say that standard quantum mechanics doesn't have it, which I never understood it, how they can. If you have a particle in the superposition here and here, it described by this state, this is quantum mechanics, it's described by density metrics. This is complete local description of what's going on here. Now, if I make a measurement here, I change it. Never mind, I find it or not find it. I mean, if I not find it, then it will be this density metrics. If I don't find it, it will be another density metrics. But clearly, not this one. And this might be another galaxy. So, no way to, and it has a meaning. It has operational meaning. Like, I can bet before this measurement, I can bet on every measurement here, I know it's 50%. Now, somebody, my friend, made a measurement here. Now, I will not bet. So, it's, yes.
Okay, but you will only stop betting when you get the information that your friend did this measurement and you got this outcome, and the information has to travel.
No. I am with my friend here. You are my friend, and you have another pair.
Okay.
So there's a particle there, but we discuss about experiments there.
Okay.
So you measure it. If you measure or not measure, I will change my behavior relative to this. This is clearly something about local thing here.
How do you know that he measures, actually?
We have seasoned factor that we collaborate on the quantum experiment, so I know that we created this EPR pair. We created the EPR pair, and we sit, and then he's drinking coffee with me now, so he's not in the lab, so he doesn't measure, but he's in the we're in the room, and I know that he has an access to this other. I know the story, I know that the photon is here and here. And there is no problem today really to have fibers, we can have what kind of distance we can have photon superposition. Yeah, the Chinese did it to satellite, so yeah. Probability.
Should I talk about probability? What am I supposed to
give time to questions and I have to finish in 20 minutes, yes?
Yes.
I think I prefer a question. There will be no question, we'll come back to probability or maybe sometimes later. Let me just go to this, yes, interaction free measurement, but then I'll finish. Okay, interaction free measurement, why I think it's important for me, kind of for believing in many words. The original interaction free measurement was like you have this object which explodes if you touch it. And then I find it, the object here, without exploding. Today I think this is, it sounds very kind of, I think it's also kind of bad, but this is kind of classical language. This is a classical language. There is no object for, because classically, I think when a photon touch it, but when I have this photon in superposition, how I think it, for me, the interaction free measurement is, there is another sense. I know that when I perform this experiment, I get this forbidden click. Yes, when I get this forbidden click. Not only that this bomb is not exploded, I know that there is no any trace whatsoever of my photon here. Because for me, the photon, if something was here, not here, I will talk about it maybe later. If all objects, everything, go here and leave some trace, maybe a tiny trace, but the quantum state of this place changed. I know that in this experiment, with single photon and this click, nothing changed here whatsoever, nothing. So I got information about some place without any object being there. And this is, for me, unacceptable. So how to accept it? In parallel world, there is an explosion. So in parallel world, the photon was there. Now, where come my intuition? It came from physics. Physics talks about the universe. It talks about all worlds together. So it's not so strange that using some kind of clever trick in this world, I know something, but it's not that because nothing was there. It was there in parallel world. So my intuition should be good for the whole physics together, not just for my world. It would have all kind of strange things in our particular world. Things have to be not paradoxical in all worlds together. We have Bell inequalities, all this, because we live in particular worlds. Then we see, kind of, looks like non-locality, looks like randomness, looks like... But if we look at all worlds together, everything now is nice, everything deterministic, everything has nothing, no action at the distance. So this is why I think that many worlds answer essentially all paradoxes of interpretation of quantum.
Persuade us that why we should accept many world interpretations. You have done this. You have undone the experiment. You believe there in the result of this. So, for instance, what does it mean to undo this this experiment with the explosion in one of the many worlds? What? How can you justify?
My main reason of believing in many worlds is not that with I have nice equations of the type which I studied from high school up to the end of my study at university. which kind of always, which explain everything which I see around. Now this experiment which I said, it's kind of additional one. If somebody really doesn't believe in it, I will, this is conceptual, I don't believe, because I say it's not really to make persuasive experiment of this type, the technology is not here. And it will not be here for a very long time. But even today, the technology is that quantum mechanics works everywhere. And first it works, and then there are these scientific ideas of action and determinism, and that, yeah, I think it's very strange that today science can explain essentially almost everything around. This is a miracle. And then, but this science has all this kind of basic principle. There is no randomness, and there is no action at a distance. And the only way for randomness and action at a distance is just because we don't want to believe that there are some of our copies. This is why I believe that all the, it's not that kind of special experiment. Again, I'm involved in kind of a quantum experiment, and I see it works with very high precision, but it's not that it's not that I will I have to wait until this and this all this experiment. I think Deutsch was first to write a paper about three types of experiments, slightly different. How to test quantum, how to test many words. This is not the main reason.
Do you think that the first one might be a silly one, but does it follow from your interpretation that if someone does an experiment with photon, say in the laboratory, that the whole world, that is all the people around, also split up into a different world?
The concept of world is kind of concept of our concept to explain our experience. So I have this definition. In a word, all macroscopic objects are well localized. It means that if somebody on the moon will perform stargalactic experiment or any kind of quantum experiment, immediately he will split the world. I will say it's very important that after he made this experiment, I am still in both worlds. He split the world. But he didn't split me, because I'm in words up and words down. So it's not the word, it's my concept, and my, I had this concept, a global concept. And in the world I do not allow supernova exploded and not exploded superposition. But if it's far away, then I'm in both worlds, and for me it doesn't matter.
So you don't ever notice anything about you splitting up? So no one ever noticed that.
If I send some satellites there and program it to perform an experiment, I know that now the number of words split, but nothing happened to me whatsoever. And then it might change my betting about, because if I know that people didn't make the experiment, I can bet there is an electron up Z. I will bet 50% on X if I know that no one measured. I know that somebody measured, I will not bet, because somebody might know it. So, but it's not, nothing changed here.
And then you throw it.
Yes?
I want to know whether there is a precise mathematical inscription of what a world is. I mean, mathematically precise by, you also would have to say what a macroscopic object is. Something like that. Just have the wave function on some R2-3 n space for n particles. The question is then what is the world?
Maybe I didn't say it loud enough. No. There is a precise description of kind of mathematical part, of physical part. Wave function evolves precisely. There is an exact equation for the wave function.
Yes.
World is a concept. I define it, especially, and again, my definition, macroscopic object, well-localized. What's macroscopic is vague, what's well-localized is vague, and as I mentioned, Everett has completely different story. It's for observer. So for him, if somebody else made the measurement there, nothing happened to him. He doesn't say he's a relative state. What is the state relative to him? So for him, the words are different, which is also okay, but I like more.
Everett defines the distinct roles only with respect to one observer.
Yes, because it's written relative state formulation.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, just.
Is there an upper bound on how many copies we might have? Like.
Again, this is the number of words is at first it's not well defined. You can play with it. There is some bound. There are questions. Every time I use my word splitter, I split the word. Every time Jan uses his single photon detector, he splits the word. So, some people say that the word split many times by when you don't do special quantum experiment. But this is a hard physics to discuss. If there are some less. Okay. So, once I mentioned, you have broken neon light. So usually it'll break the world. You can notice when it flashes or some other things, but it's not clear.
Even for instance, if we do consider that, suppose we have two worlds, two different worlds, like one over here and somewhere. So the amount of information that both of them will have, the combined information content, which we might define in terms of bits, that would exceed the number of atoms. So that would create a problem, right?
This is, for example.
Right now there is some limit of 10^122 bits, classical bits of information.
I think it's not an accident that the inventor of quantum computer was David Deutsch, who believed in many worlds. What he did, he found a way how to make parallel computation, but in different worlds. But we cannot get all inside. When we have this, bring them together, we can only take some parts from this. So in every world there is a computation, there are bounds how many bits. But then if you make it parallel computation, then you can get it much more. And what quantum computer do is kind of use this in a clever way to make a speed up, because he used some bits from different one. But in principle, this word and this word have separately the same, and sometimes you can arrange taking something from here and here and get some advantage. Yes?
For you,
Kalax
is near to human experiments, or for instance, radioactive decay. So every time there is a decay, there is a
speeding. If I have, I think once I gave a popular lecture on many words with a Geiger counter and some radiative device from our laboratory, very soon people told me stop with it. So, if I have only a radiative kind of material, which make the case, nothing happens. When I have a Geiger counter, when make clicks, this would split the world. When I have an electron which go and split here, the world didn't split. It split when there is an explosion or click. So I need a microscopic device which finds some quantum event. That this is what creates a world. Yes.
You mentioned the paper by Dickey on indirect machine measurement,
yeah,
that he sends light through half of the box, and if it doesn't hit the particle, then we know it was the other half. And then he analyzed that with feed theory, if I remember right.
Yes.
And he said
two papers, yes.
Yeah. So what looked like no interaction actually is an interaction from the point of view of field theory. So I just wonder if there's some, you know, if the bomb tester has been analyzed in this way, that there actually is some kind of interaction.
after many word paper, after this, not many, after this interaction free measurement, there were many, many papers with attacking and giving different names and saying what's, if it's interaction free or not interaction free, in which sense. So is Hamiltonian there, so what, why, what do you say there is no interaction in one sense? Some people say it's energy exchange free, it's whatever, which I think it's all not true. There is energy, momentum exchange, energy exchange, everything. There is a one concrete thing. I know that there is something here, and the photon was not here, from the meaning that it left no trace whatsoever. This is the meaning. If it was in superposition, there was Hardy paradox, when you have two of them together, there are all kinds of... There are, it's... the word interaction-free, some people say interrogation-free, some other thing. There are all kinds of things. From my point of view, the meaning, when it's interaction-free, in my world, I find some information here without being there. And without being, no trace left here. This is, for me, what it's interaction-free. I think it was here some... Yes?
Yeah, I have two questions. First of all, I'm not sure I understand... So basically, in many worlds, wave function describes everything. Wave function is all there is.
Yeah.
But, so I'm not sure in your version of many worlds, how do you get the emergence of classical behavior?
When I have a well-localized wave packet in the shape of a kit. It's a kit.
Yeah.
And I don't think it's too much different from, for example, again, by connection. The standard quantum mechanics believes in collapse, and then they're happy. Everyone understands that electron cannot be exactly well localized. They say, but if it's a kind of split, finally it's detected, it is here. But after the collapse, people are happy. This particle, Newtonian particle was replaced by kind of localized wave packet for electron. And everyone kind of happy, and I think it's similar to other interpretation. In GLW, it's exactly the same. We have a very localized wave packet. In BOM, we have some point, but it's very localized because it can live only inside the wave packet. So there is not much, the story is pretty similar. So I have stories when my cat has many, many points in the shape of cat. Our cat has many, many well localized wave packets, which is GLW, standard quantum mechanics, and many worlds.
So I'm still looking at it from many worlds perspective, but I'm looking at it from like the relative state interpretation. So this brings into my second question. Like, I don't understand why. So I accept everything that you said, but I don't understand how you can't fit into like Everett's original for formalism, or the way that people like I didn't talk about it over there as well. The way people like David Wallace push many worlds.
I didn't find any. Tell me exactly what. Maybe some example of what exactly you mean different. Especially Wallace, I think, wrote more papers on many worlds than anyone else in the last 20 years. So.
Yeah, basically, what I'm trying to say is from what I understand, you said macro states cannot be entangled.
By definition, this is what from word is. Of course, you can decompose it differently.
Yeah.
I decompose in such a way, that macroscopic objects are not entangled with some others.
Okay.
And this is what, how I make correspondence from my experience to word experience to cat's experience. Cat will have one experience, dead or alive.
Yes.
It will be different in different world. In every word, there is only one single experience.
So I'm a little confused with this word many world. Are you going to pointing towards many body? Because
no,
you have written a wave function, it looks like a many.
There's
body
a
whole
story that there are many. Again, as I said, there is one word like I'm kind of now talking, and there is a parallel word when I'm probably standing somewhat differently, because I split the world and started to move differently. And maybe so and then from there, from now
you haven't considered any gravity and all.
Gravity, maybe it will change the story. Till now, I know the old physics, which I know, which is not gravity, is well understood. Gravity, I'm not aware of any consistent story.
Usually,
gravity
call
is not
it
here.
As a multiverse, if you have many worlds with gravity.
David Deutsch called it multiverse. I like
yeah.
to call it there is a one physical universe. And there are many worlds because there is no multiverse. It's like there is only one universe. There is only one wave function. But then there are many stories, and then depending on how it decomposes in this world. Yes, I think.
So, what is the exact nature of coexistence of the worlds inside the universe?
This we definitely have some experience what we see around, and the science is supposed to explain this experience. So the night, which was Newton, said the world is made out of particles that move like this, and everything was a great picture. Unfortunately, it's wrong. So people say, no, we cannot, particle cannot have exact trajectories, exact position. Everything is kind of wave. And then the right wave equation. With particles, when you go through something, you can understand sometimes it scatters, sometimes it goes through. But the wave goes both ways. And it doesn't correspond to what we see. We send the particle and we see it here or here. This is the problem. And so this problem, many words answers. The many words says, yes, it goes both here and here, and here there is one experience where we see it scattered, and another experience where we see it's not scattered. So explain our experience. This is the role using equations of physics. Equations of physics are quantum equations. Because that equations shown to be in laboratory not correct.
Okay, so these two experiments, the one that succeeds in or the one that fails, or one in one way or one in another way, are they superposed, are they parallel, what is
in
the
physical universe they parallel.
So
but they both exist. Now there is some other equation I never mentioned, the coherence or whatever.
So what do you mean by parallel? Does it mean that the world stops and then there's another one? Is there another one?
Here, probably another me kind of going through me.
Okay, but where is it the other
way? Here, it's the same. I don't play with space-time. It's another question, but this is a gravity, how to make space-time and whatever. I take space for granted, of course, I don't want to take non-relativistic quantum mechanics. I want relativistic quantum mechanics, but not gravity, I don't know how to do it. So the time is parameter, I don't play with it, and it's just in the same space, in this room, so there is me, definitely there is me, but in different position, maybe it will be finished, or another way not. Maybe there is, I don't know, maybe this place it's not finished, because I don't know what's up as a parallel world. I have only some information about parallel worlds. All I have memory of some quantum experiment. I know that all this quantum experiment got all outcomes, but maybe I don't know what all parallel worlds. Maybe there are more things.
Okay, so but we cannot see the other you right now. So what is the nature of? There must be a limit between these two worlds. What is the nature of the limit?
I'm not sure. It's we cannot see because technology will bring some super technology which doesn't exist. It will not exist. We cannot make interference of. We hardly make interference with 1,000 atoms. We cannot make interference with 10 to the 23 atoms. It's not feasible in any way whatsoever. And so interactions. So we'll not. But everything. I think the science is supposed to give us explanation of what we see around. And the science have theory, and it gives us perfect explanation of everything what we see around. We need for this either some miracle, which is very unscientific, like collapse. Or we have to admit that there are parallel worlds, which I think it's...
But that is not explaining what we see around, because we don't see it in the other parallel
worlds. We see one world.
Yeah.
But to find the elegant theory to see this one world, I have to accept that there are parallel worlds. Otherwise, I don't have an elegant theory.
Okay, but let's then analyze these parallel worlds. What are the nature of these? exact nature of
this
the
world. Like ours.
How are they organized one another?
Yeah.
How can we pass from one to another?
No, we can't.
Is it, is
no,
it
for, the, for this, the only thing we can, in principle, we can reunite and
yeah.
when we split and then interfere with it. So there's no interaction between different worlds.
Another question, you said that you were, that there were several you, but at another moment you said that only macroscopic or
several lives, not I can be only in one place. I cannot be in two
okay,
places.
Okay, so there's no several worlds with you.
No, I think I as a consciousness. So the consciousness is, if I understand correctly, is it also a microscopic object and therefore it's tied to a one instance of my consciousness is tied to a specific world. So therefore you experience, so that's because you asked about the mechanism how you experience worlds. So in the same space you have these many worlds, but your particular instance of your consciousness is as a microscopic object element of one of these worlds.
So you are saying consciousness is a microscopic object.
Because
that
is yeah, the consciousness is problematic. Some
I
people say, for me, there is no, as I think I might, I was trying to be provocative and trying to say that the electric kettle has consciousness as I do. So then that's everything. Yeah. But we need, my experience, I need to be well localized. And I can be well localized only in one word. But I understand that the chairman says that I have to stop.
Yes. Time is finite, and maybe.